some of the downside of a 1031 exchange?
One of the biggest downsides is time.
Time?
Yeah, 45 days to identify and automate the vote.
That's right.
45 days.
So what happens with a 1031 exchange is you have a property that you can roll up into a new property without having to pay income taxes. It keeps getting deferred out, right? So here you have a property, you have a buyer, you get in the middle of this is what they call an EA. Now, I'm an EA, I'm an enrolled agent, so I always forget what an EA is. It's a exchange accommodator. Okay. There's a lot of EAs out there for EA acronyms.
Remember they called the middleman?
Yeah, that's what I'm about, but that's who takes control of the asset. So the buyer pays cash in consideration to an EA, and the EA will replace that property. The seller deeds you the replacement property, and that's basically how it works. Now, I've been told, I haven't done, now, the problems with some of the 1031 exchanges John mentioned, it's hard to find that property. Everything has to be in the right timing. So we have something called tenants in common. It's a 1031 tick. So our company does those. So what that means is if you have a property, let's say you have an apartment complex, $5 million. You can turn it over to, and you're tired of it. You're tired of handling the management of it. You just wanted the income, right? So sometimes when you do a 1031 exchange, you're just trading one property nightmare or another property nightmare. So what you can do is transfer it over to the TIC, which they have a whole bunch of property. They're going to handle all the property management. So let's say you transfer it and say instead of 100% owner on this $5 million property you have, you can transfer it and say I want 20% of a $20 million property. And they handle the management and they give you an income stream of let's say 7%. And you could still have capital appreciation when that property sells. So it is out there, but it's a timing thing. So if you can't find the right property at the time you want to do that and not pay taxes, give me a call. Find a TIC to take over that property. Okay, so the monetized installment sale is really the conversation that we had on the radio station. It's installment sale is basically works this way. So I have an asset I want to sell. You want to buy the property, but you don't have the cash, so I'm going to finance you, and you can pay me over time, which is great for me because I'm going to pay taxes as I receive that income, right? It's great for the buyer. It's great for the economy because you have money in motion. So the IRS loves it, okay? The problem is if I'm a seller, said, okay, I want to sell it. I'd rather have my money. I don't want to deal with this guy forever. You may default on me. There's all kinds of problems associated with it. So I want to do a monetized installment sale. So what that is, it's basically an installment sale that we create a loan. There's three sections to this. The first section is you have to have a buyer and a seller. So in the first instance up here, the seller is going to sell it to a dealer. And in this case, this is proprietary information. I'm limited to what I can share in a group setting. But Stan, or Escrow Collateral Corporation, is our dealer. They're our dealer in capital assets. So you're going to sell the property. We already have the buyer in place. The property is sold to the dealer. Instantaneously, the buyer pays the dealer for the asset. That's step one. Step two is we create, yes.
You're selling the asset to the dealer on the installment sale.
Correct.
You just kind of left that.
Well, so. Yes. It's in an installment sale. So right here we have an installment sale. under section C 453. The second piece is we have a separate loan. So this is a non-recourse loan. Under Dodd-Frank, there's certain banks cannot enter into this, so we have a separate company that's been set up to do them. A non-recourse loan means they can't attach the property. So they're gonna, this lender right here is gonna lend up to 95% of the sale. So are loans taxable income? Are they taxable income? No. So on $1 million property, 95% of that is what? $950,000 that you can use to invest or reinvest or pay off debt, whatever it is that you're gonna do.
You have that because you're selling it, or because?
I'm sorry?
You have that money because you sold some property, or because you're buying it?
There is a lender that has a relationship with the dealer company as pro collateral that is willing. What happens with this money? The buyer that pays the dealer company, that goes into a trust fund. It goes into a trust that they segregate, and every month, that which is the third piece, actually is used to pay the monthly interest. So let me go over this again. We create an installment sale. The seller sells the property to the dealer. The buyer pays the dealer cash. That money goes into escrow, into a trust account. Simultaneously, a loan is created and will pay the seller up to 95% of those proceeds up front, right now, immediately. It has to go into an interest-bearing account, like a savings account, any type of account, for 30 days. That's the only requirement by the IRS. Now, they're willing to do this because this money's in a trust account. So the third piece here is really understanding the mechanics of this loan. The loan is an interest-only loan. It's due and payable in 30 years. Each month, the lender goes into Stan Crow's company, escrow collateral, and pulls out that interest-only payment. That interest-only payment is at 6%. At the end of the year, you would get two 1099s, one for interest paid, one for interest earned. So the reason why the bank is willing to do this, because when you're taking out a loan, you're not on any credit reporting, nothing. It's all done automatically. The reason why they're willing to do this is because if you looked at any 30-year period, the stock market's gonna earn pay between 8 and 10%. So they're very comfortable. There's strict guidelines on how that money that Stan Crow escrow collateral company gets, how they invest it, okay? Okay, that's a lot to take in. Questions so far?
So the property was $1 million. I got $950,000 right off the bat after I wait my 30 days. The installment loan is in for the additional $50,000 that I'm going to receive over 30 years.
Well, Stan Crow, they make that 5% at the end of 30 years. So that's why it's not a 100% loan. There is a cost there in not into doing this. We're not making any money. They make their 5% at the end of the loan.
Think of it as a discounted note. They're discounting the value of that 5% up front.
So my only taxable portion is discounted over the life of 30 years.
Yeah. I got a screen up here that'll kind of show you, because two things happen. If you have owed $100,000 in taxes today and you didn't have to pay it for 30 years and you earned 5% on that money, it would be worth over $400,000. So that's one. The second thing is inflation becomes your friend. what happens is you're paying taxes with discounted dollars in the future. So that 100,000, 30 years from now at a 3% inflation would be 40 grand. So you want to pay 40 grand? You want to pay 40 grand in the future.
So what's the minimum loan? I mean, these guys aren't going to do this for 10 grand. So, or, you know, they must have a limit for the deal size.
Yeah. I have a case right now up at the lake. There's actually two properties that equal $1 million. I'd like to see $1 million because it really makes sense. We can really make this thing save them a lot of money. The bare minimum is $500,000. So you can see why I do these in California a lot, because it doesn't take much to have $1 million properties here, but we're coming back up. That we're starting to do more and more.
Is that 500 or a million in equity?
Net proceeds. I'm going to give you an example.
Okay,
in fact, I'm going to give you an example right now. Let's do this. Kim, can you help me with this?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Yes. So we'll do a quick study so you can see this and look at numbers, and I think this helps. How this thing first came about was several years ago. I got introduced to this and really didn't pay that much attention to it. And then I had a company that was selling an oil company in the Dakotas, and they were going to have to pay a boatload of money. So the attorneys had found out about this. They found out that I knew about it because I had shared it with one of their accountants. And turned out, long story short, they didn't end up selling that. They didn't end up selling the company. They just kept it. But one of the people on the board of directors is the president of the bank who contacted me. He had a highly appreciated property down in Corona Del Mar. It was a personal residence. Their basis in the contract was about one, and their property was about 1.5, including the marital deduction. The property was over 3 million. So we're looking at 1.5 million that was subject to taxes, and this is very close to the case numbers that he was gonna have to pay. So what you're looking at is this price on this property was 1.2 million. The cost to sell with title, commissions, and whatnot was about 8%, so that's $96,000. The net sale proceeds is $1.1 million. Their basis in the property, in this case, was $225,000 for a taxable gain of $879,000. So that's the number that we're paying taxes on. So $879,000 at federal level, capital gains at 20% gives us $175,800 there. We have the, we call it Obama tax here, but Medicare is 3.8. We have the exclusion amount for a single at their threshold is $200,000, so the amount we're paying tax at 3.8 on $679,000. So that gives us another $25,802 of tax. If you look on the depreciation on the other side of the chart, we have some recapture here. 25% tax rate was $4,900. We have debt over basis. We'll have a little conversation about that. But the mortgage on that one is $489,000, less adjusted basis of $205,000, less our tax relief, and they're in a 33% tax bracket. So there's $93,000 in taxes right there. So if I just added the federal level, we're at over $300,000 of tax. They're also in California, so he has to pay 13.3% state tax, because in California it's ordinary income, it's not capital gain at the state level. So if you looked at projected federal state taxes, it's $457,000. I know, it's serious. Serious money. So now look down below. On the left-hand side shows without planning. I have my 1.2 million property. After all my costs and taxes, I'm left to reinvest in my next thing or provide an income on $157,000. That's it. That's all I get. With this type of planning, we now have 632,000, almost 633,000 that we can do something with. So it's very, very powerful. People don't like to pay taxes, and as a real estate investor or a real estate professional, you will get more people to help that will sell property when you have these kind of tools that can help them move that property. Let me give you an example on the security side. I had a guy with almost $3 million of Pfizer stock. This is pre-crash. So I told them, you know, Enron went down. That's when, they had all their money with one company, their wages and everything. So I'm talking to him about diversification. I mean, diversification is how you minimize risk. Oh, no, no, Jamie, then I got to pay all them capital gains. And I go, well, you're subject, to risk. So then what happened is the market went down. The stock dropped. So that almost $3 million was almost down in half. And you might need to consider diversifying. Oh, no, no, then, I got to wait till it comes back up. So he was just in love with the stock. You can't do anything. But if you had a tool, now you can't do this with securities, but if you had a tool to do this, somebody would be willing to maybe move that property and you'll create more sales. Okay.
On this example,
yes.
So the basis of the property is 225, but the worried about was 49. So that means you pull money out of it.
They pulled money from it.
All right, so that's where a big hit of that went.
Yeah.
So he had more than that in just loans.
Yeah, and you can maybe comment on this too. Some accountants may do debt over basis like this, and some don't.
Okay.
So it just kind of depends on who your tax advisor is. I've seen it both ways.
Okay.
Here's a real cost of selling. So you have capital gains, 20%. We have depreciation, 2%. Medicare tax, 3.8. We don't have state tax here.
Yet.
let's hope not. Estate professional, 6% selling costs. Closing costs, 1.5. We add that up, 42.6%. That's including the state. Now let's talk about debt over basis for a second. Let's say we have this property, $850,000 net sales price. If we have our mortgage debt, $778,000, net our basis gives us $712,900 taxable income as debt relief. This one shows federal and state at 46%. You start adding these monies up, and now we're at 81%. So somebody's not going to be selling this property knowing that they're going to get hit at 81%. That's the reality, especially in California. Typically, without coaching and planning and all this stuff, I've done stuff with even in divorces, and people just don't think, I want to get a divorce, boom, and they may have to sell a piece of property. We've had cases like that. Without proper tax planning on any decisions like that, the coaching, you're going to miss opportunities. And you don't want to have to go, I don't care how well you guys do stuff, if you show up on April 15th with your receipts and you didn't do tax planning, you could get some surprises here. So typically you'll say, hey, I got to pay taxes, I can do a 1031 exchange, I can do a traditional installment sale. And what happens with a 1031, by the way, how do you get out of it?
Die.
So that doesn't sound too exciting for me.
It's true.
But at least they get a stepped up cost.
Yeah.
What can I do next?
Yeah.
Get
a stepped-up in basis. Yeah, so that's the good news. Yeah. So here was this importance of tax deferral. No interest. So when we're looking at this, we have no interest on deferral taxes. We don't have earn money on deferred taxes. We have taxes are not adjusted for inflation. Inflation becomes your ally. Future inflation will save more than the cost. So this was the line chart that I was explaining. So I'll just take it over so you can see it. Here's our 100 grand over 30 years. It's worth well over 400,000 at 5%. Can you guys earn 5%? Take a little risk.
Also.
A little risk. And then at a 3% inflation rate, 40 cents on the dollar. That's what you'll be paying. So what would you rather pay, 100,000 or the 40? So here's some examples. These are real life cases. Elderly owner in assisted living for 5 years. The market value of their property, 1.2. They owe 600,000. Their taxes due for the year for that sale was 442.5. Needs to sell property for a profit to supplement the cost of long-term care. They have 157,600 net available at the close of escrow. So the goal was solve the tax problem, maximize amount of cost of care, or maximize the amount for cost of care. So what we did is sold the property, deferred the taxes with this program I was sharing with you, the monetized installment sale. We gave them $578,000 tax-free at the close of escrow for care. So they were able to increase benefits. This is an undeveloped property. It's a retired couple. It's 160 acres, completely paid off. They bought it in the 80s for 150. Today it's worth 640. There's no debt, no income. Capital gains, 163,000 on this property. The goal was to solve the tax problem. So we sold the property. The 163 in capital gains was eliminated. We have 256,000 in additional deductions, saving nearly 70,000 in ordinary income tax, provided them annual income of $44,600. One more problem. This is the case in Sacramento with a colleague of mine did this one. Three adult siblings inherited a family limited partnership with a bunch of property. The family limited partnership owns a corporation that owns commercial property, industrial rentals, etc. The sibling, one sibling wanted out. I just want $4 million net of taxes. I want it now. You know those kinds.
There's always one.
There's always one. So we looked at two, they looked at two properties, one $5+ million, the other one $2.9 million. There was four levels of taxation, three corporate and one personal, 40% each. Over almost 3.1 million total taxes due if we sold both properties. We were still gonna be $900,000 short of the goal. So we're able to achieve it selling only one property. The corporation received a $4.4 million tax-free net after the sale, after all the costs, $1.9 million in corporate taxes eliminated. Siblings received the $4 million tax-free at close of escrow, $1.2 million in individual taxes deferred for 30 years. It's pretty powerful. So, be proactive. That's it. So did I go an hour and a half?
So on a 1031, if I hold title in an LLC and I come out the other side, I still have to be in my LLC. Same here, where if the property is held by a limited partnership or an LLC on the back end, all that tax control and everything is coming to the entity.
Coming to the entity. And then you've got the shareholders. All of that comes in.
Correct.
Questions? Is it complicated? You know, I had to listen to this thing several times. But, Peter, can they go on and listen to the radio?
I can.
Okay.
You can go to the website and then they can download it.
Yeah, so Stan Crow, Harvard Law attorney, was really the originator of this idea. It started off that he had done a deal for his clients years ago in the 90s. And this is what he did. And then he forgot about it. Then he was in a CLE class, continuing education class for attorneys. And they were talking about 1031 exchanges. And the question came up, how do you exit a 1031 exchange? And you basically pay the taxes or die. And Stan goes, aha, I have the exception. So this is one way that if you have 1031 properties that you can get an exit strategy, not deal with the headaches before the taxes. So, love it. Yes?
I'm a little bit of, I do a lot of 1031s for clients and for myself. I'm like you, I've listened to this from John probably a dozen times. I don't get.
So what you have to do is with a property, if you have a property that you want us to do a mini analysis with, and we'll show you on that property, with or without, we'll show the 1031 exchange.
I understand without, that's not the issue. But I'm trying to understand your program in regard to...
Why do you do a 1031 exchange?
Well, I bought property 35 years ago, and I pyramided it up.
Right. So now, how are you going to get out of it?
Good question. Without doing another 1031.
Without doing another 1031. So this is your answer. We have a buyer.
So I'm going to call you and go to lunch. You tell me again how this works.
Okay. I'll do a mini analysis.
I'll join.
We can do that. So we have a little protocol on what we do with these properties, because obviously we want to be able to vet someone that they have actually a real property to do this, right? Because just for education purposes, you're going to remember it and you're going to forget about it. The whole idea about today is just know that it exists. So you can do this with any highly appreciated property. You can do this with artwork. You could do this with the sale of a business. So there's tons of things that you can do this with, but a capital asset. Right here, I want to get out. My whole thing is that I want to have some income, and I don't want to have to pay my taxes. So we have this property, we have a buyer. We enter into an installment agreement and create a loan that's non-recourse. That loan is income tax-free to you.
So I deed my property to an entity. That entity takes the cash from the buyer, creates a note, and then I turn around, refinance that note, and put the cash in the pocket?
You don't refinance anything. The dealer, escrow collateral, takes the money from the buyer, and an account is set up. And they invest that money at the lender's specification. The lender turns around immediately and writes the seller a check equal to 95% of whatever the sales price, net sales price of that property. Then what happens at the third level is the lender has an agreement with the dealer company to automatically go in and take the monthly interest payment from that account every month. Everything's done automatic. The seller doesn't do anything. The seller doesn't have to do anything. But at the end of 30 years, that note's due. So, I'm proactive. I'm not trying to escape something. I try to find ways and say, I don't want you to ever worry about these taxes. I don't want your family to worry about it. So, I fund a life insurance policy with my clients if they decide to do that. So I want to make sure I have this asset over here, this money that's growing that I have to pay the IRS and I don't have to worry about it. I'm paying it for even smaller bills on the dollar. Yes?
So who's making that first deposit payment?
Technically, it's the seller. But they don't ever write the check. The money's coming.
But where's it coming out of?
It's coming out of the investment account. The buyer gave the dealer money. It created an investment account, an escrow account, and that's where the money, the interest payment comes out of every month.
So the loan gets the investment account?
Yes. That's where the payment is being processed out of.
Okay.
So
who gets the money that's in that investment account?
Escrow collateral, the dealer is investing those proceeds.
And whose money is that? So I've got my cash out, and this money in this investment account, whose money is that? Or is there anything actually even left there?
So actually that money right there is because they sold, the seller sold it to escrow, but they didn't actually write a check to the seller. So a separate transaction is a there was a loan, a lender willing to give up to 95% to the seller that they can use now for investment purposes. At the end of 30 years, the taxes will be due. Yes.
At the end of 20 years, the seller dies.
It's in an estate. Okay, so we didn't talk about estate planning, which we can discount notes significantly for estate planning purposes, so that could even come down. But it's basically a note for 30 years, so it's in the estate. So if we want to sell an estate, we have to discount that note even further.
So you can't die and get out of that.
Yeah, your estate will handle that.
Not really. What happens is, if I've got $500,000 left in this note, what would you pay for a note that $500,000 is going to be paid over the next 10 years or 15 years? Would you give $500,000 to pay for it?
No.
You discount it.
Yeah. Completely, severely
so
discount it.
Instead of your heirs paying taxes on $500,000, I'm going to give them 100 grand for it, or
yeah,
whatever somebody would give it, so it would go into your estate at that value, that reduced value.
We haven't had anybody die yet.
Pardon me?
We haven't had anybody die. We've been doing these like 10 years, 5 years, complete list is all that they do now, but it's basically we've been doing these for 10 years. So
you don't have to have,
but
you
I can
don't have to own a home. Free and clear, you can still have a home that has a mortgage on it.
Yes.
And also the lease deed there.
Yes.
Who sets the limit at $500,000?
The lender. You know, it's just
to
a
make it worth
yeah to make it worth their yeah they're doing multi-million-dollar deals and it's just.
So you can group properties.
Yes.
$500,000.
Yes.
You can. Is there a limit on how many?
Well, the two properties up in Tahoe, I don't know which one's going to sell first or how long it's going to take, but those are tied in together to
okay.
make it work because one property was under $500,000 and one's over.
Okay, total $500,000 at least. Okay, perfect.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Benefits the buyer also take
the buyer just wants the property, unencumbered. They got it. You know, they're going to have their own mortgage, they're going to have their own thing, so.
They're not affected by that.
They're not affected
they
by that at all.
They come up with a full amount, they're not paying. You were saying something about paying in the
No, the seller sells the property to the dealer under section C-453, which is an installment loan.
That doesn't have anything to do with the buyer.
It has nothing to do with the buyer.
The buyer just
pays cash, because as a dealer, as a real estate dealer, you have an inventory of property. So somebody sells you the property and you may want to flip it, you may want to rehab it. I mean, it's designed as inventory. So when they sell it, they have to pay ordinary income when they sell that property.
So in the case of two properties in Tahoe,